Welcome back to When Harry Met Board Games, where we feed our people with relatable content, and our victory condition is your satisfaction. I'm Harry, and don't forget to subscribe to our channel and click on that bell notification. That way, when we're doing our thing, YouTube lets you know. Today, we're going to have another board game comparison, and I'm very excited to be comparing these two games here, Palazzo and Alhambra. One, a Reiner Knizia design, and another one, Dirk Hen. Let's get to the overscreen to see these games, their components, and how they play, and then we're going to get back to my final thoughts. So the first thing we're going to compare is the components or the production quality. So Alhambra, first of all, has seen more, reprints, second printings, and new upgraded editions. Just recently, they really had a really nice, prettied up edition with more garish-like colors. So it has that going in its favor. It has been a more successful game. It's the Spiel des Jahres winner for 2003. Palazzo has been more under the radar. Also, Queen Games versus Rio Grande Games. I tend to prefer the production quality in Queen Games over those of Rio Grande Games. So from a production quality perspective, this is a much more appealing box here than this one from the cover. And even if you look at the components here, the advantage will be in favor of Alhambra. You have this nice little score track, which you can consider to be superfluous, but it serves a purpose and aesthetically pleasing and very thematic, right? The idea of building the Alhambras. You have this board here to represent the different markets where you'll be drafting the tiles. And then you have the tiles themselves, which are squared shape, and they have nice little pieces of different types of buildings, right, that you're drafting throughout the game, and they're all color-coded. So that is really, really cool. This game, Palazzo, this is like the main material board, which will have lots of different tiles pile up there. And then the markets are basically four little boards that you surround the main material supply board with. And then you have the actual building tiles, and they're rectangular in shape and much more basic. There's three types of colors, and none of these stand out. There's this white color here, this beige color, and this brownish color here. And that's pretty much it as far as the different colors. So you have the cards, which serve for money. So here you have, for Alhambra, you have these standard-sized cards. Very standard-sized cards. And then for this game here, Palazzo, you have these small Euro-sized cards, which are very typical in Euro games for these small-sized cards. And as far as the aesthetic appeal of them is concerned, I would have to give the slight advantage at least to Alhambra. It has a nice little symbol there to distinguish. All the symbols are mostly the same. Well, not really. They're actually different. So yeah, you even have a different symbol here to distinguish the different currencies. You don't really have a different symbol. They're just color-coded, but the number, based on the number, you'll see more of these coin images on the actual card. And that's pretty much it. So yeah, definitely I'm going to have to give, without a shadow of a doubt, the edge for production quality to Alhambra over Palazzo. So now we're going to compare setup and gameplay. So over here to the left we have Alhambra, and here on the right we have Palazzo. So basically for Alhambra, you have this market here, which is where you will randomly throughout the game be drawing the tiles, the building tiles, and placing them on the corresponding, well, on the emptied market spaces as they empty out. And basically each of the market spaces corresponds to a particular color, which is the currency card that you must use in order to buy buildings from said market. Now here in Palazzo, what we have is we have a material supply board right here, and then four other market boards that surround it. We also have this master builder who, as the game progresses, will be rotating clockwise, and this will determine which market is available for auction when players so choose to bid. Also, the master builder will be used as a reference point for which market we place these different building tiles on. Very important, while in Alhambra, you are randomly drawing the tiles here. This game is a little bit more structured in the sense that you have three stacks of building tiles labeled 1, 2, and 3, right? And each stack is a little bit bigger than the previous one. And this is where we find all of our buildings. So as the game progresses, you will find more valuable buildings available to you, while with Alhambra, it is all randomized. So there's that. Also, we have our decks of cards, and they're shuffled. And the difference between Alhambra and Palazzo, as far as your starting hand is concerned, in Palazzo, you will get a starting hand of 4 cards no matter what, right? So for example here, I got 2 of these gray currency cards in 6 and 3, denominations of 6 and 3. And here, these are brown cards are actually the wilds. They can be comboed with any other card. So Palazzo does have a wild card, which Alhambra, at least the base game, does not have any. Now, Alhambra has a market of cards that are available to you, visibly available to you, and that's how you will be drawing cards throughout the game. While in Palazzo, the cards will always remain in the deck, shuffled face down as hidden information. So the starting hand for Alhambra will be drawing 1 card at a time visibly so your opponents can hold you accountable until you have 20 or more worth of currency. So far I drew an 8. Now I drew a 1, so that's a total of 9. Another 8 puts us at 17. And a 7 puts us at 24. So now I am over the 20 mark. And because of that, I am done drawing my initial hand on Alhambra. So that's the case of Alhambra. You'll know that you'll have at least 20 worth of money before the game begins. Okay, so there is that. Now let's talk a little bit about gameplay. So first of all, on Alhambra and in Palazzo, one thing they have in common is that you can typically only get 1 action per turn, but you have a few options as to how many things you can choose from to do. So first of all, in Alhambra, you could always choose to purchase a tile from the market as long as you have enough money to pay for it within that market's color currency. So for example, I have 7 in orange, but this building tile here in the orange market is worth 8, so I wouldn't be able to afford it. But I have more than enough yellow to buy this one worth 10 in the yellow market. Now, the neat thing about Alhambra is that even though technically you only get 1 action per round, there is a way of acquiring additional actions. For example, if you are able to purchase a building tile for the exact amount that it's worth, not overpaying, because there's no getting change back in Alhambra. If you overpay, too bad, so sad. But if you're able to pay the precise amount that's on that building tile's value, you are rewarded. The game rewards you with a bonus action. So theoretically, even though I've never seen it done, you can get up to 5 actions in a turn, because if for whatever reason you're able to buy all 4 of the available building tiles on the 4 colored markets, if you're able to buy all 4 of them for the exact price they're worth, then that would have been 4 actions, plus it would reward you with a 5th one, right? Now, what are some of the other options you could do with your turn in Alhambra? You can draft money cards. And again, the value in Alhambra is that they are visibly available to you. So you could draft either 1 card, add it to your hand, or you can draft multiple cards as long as their total value is equal to or lower than 5. So for example, I could draft this yellow 4 and this green 1 because the total is equal to 5. So there's that. And then you will replace it at the end of your turn and so on and so forth. So that's another thing you could do with your action, your 1 action in Alhambra. You could either draft a building tile or you can draft a card. Another thing you could do with your turn is you can take you have this little supply player board where if you ever draft a building tile and for whatever reason you cannot use it or you choose not to use it, you can lay it away over here, and there is no maximum over here. And on a future turn, you can use an action or a bonus action to place this onto your Alhambra, or to replace an existing tile on your Alhambra with this one. So you can either add it straightforward or make an exchange in the exact spot for another tile. So those are your options as far as it's concerned, because technically when you draft a tile or when you purchase a tile, it's at the end of your round, when you're done with your actions, that you will place it on your Alhambra. So now let's talk about the options here in Palazzo. Palazzo, there is no way of having multiple turns or multiple actions in a turn. You will only get one. Your options, though, are either to buy a building. And the way you buy a building is you can either pay for it with the in the material supply and get it with no competition from your opponents. And the way it would work is these tiles, every time you choose to buy, you draft the top tile here and it goes into the material supply. Then you will draft the second tile. You will look at how many windows there are on the tile. In this case, there are two windows. And you will count that many spaces clockwise from wherever the master builder pawn is. And that's the market in which you'll place this tile on. So we will count one, two spaces, and now it's right here. So after we've done that, after you've made your drawn the top two tiles and you've seen what's there, that's when you make your decision to either buy something from the material supply straight up, or you can choose to put one of the markets up for auction. Now, if I choose to buy something from here, the cost of each tile here, which they can pile up as the game progresses, for example, the cost would always be 10 coins or 10 money for each tile minus the amount of tiles that are actually there in the material supply. So for example, right now we have 3 tiles here. So you would take 10 minus 3, and that's 7. Each tile here is worth 7 money. Now, you can never purchase more than 2 tiles from the material supply no matter what, right? So let's say we're looking for each of them to be worth 7. I don't have enough money here to pay for 14. So I would have to do something like this and pay 8 in order to get one of these tiles and add it to my player area. And basically, that would be it. Now, let's talk about the auction bidding. With the auction bidding, what's interesting is everything that's on this market would be up for grabs. First of all, you trigger an auction. The first thing you do is you rotate the master builder one space clockwise. And let's just say that there were a few tiles here up for grabs. All of that would be up for grabs for whoever wins the auction. Now, why would an active player choose to have the auction when they could grab something here and have no competition? Well, they do have this Certificato card, which basically gives them an initial bid of 3 every time they enter into an auction. This is only available to the active player, the player whose turn it is. So the active player does have a slight advantage in that auction as far as winning, because they will have 3 money less to pay. And once you win an auction, the winner of the auction, whether it's the active player or not, will draw all the tiles, and then they'll decide what to do with them. So I've explained one action, which is the buying action. Now let's talk about the other things you could do. So the other two actions you can choose to take is you can choose to get money. And the way you would get money is you always draw from the deck. You draw 2 cards plus 1 for every other player playing the game. So let's say we're playing a 3-player game. We'll draw 2 more. The active player would look at these cards. They would choose 2 for their own. So let's say these 2 really high-valued ones of the same currency. They would choose 2 of their own. And then they would pass the remaining 2 to the next player clockwise. And then the next player would choose one of these 2 and then again pass the remaining card to the other player. So every time you choose the game money action in Palazzo, Even though you're going to be helping yourself a lot, you will be helping your opponents out a little bit. So that's something to think about. And finally, the third and final action you could do in a palazzo is you can choose to reorganize one of your buildings. Because as you're acquiring your buildings, you're laying them down. Sometimes you're placing them on top of each other in sequential order, 1, 2, 3 for the different levels. But what might happen is that on a future turn, you might draft a building or buy a building tile that actually can go in between two other levels. And what you could do is you could use one of your actions to slip that building tile into that those two levels so that you can have a more complete structure. So yes, if you ever want to do something like that, you would have to actually take a whole turn in order to do so, but it might just be worth it for the reward on the other side. Okay, so that's it as far as the options for the actions are concerned. Now let's talk a little bit about the currencies. As I mentioned before, in Alhambra, whenever you want to buy from a particular market, you need to use the amount or the color that corresponds with that market. In Palazzo, there are no colors corresponding to the market, so you can use whatever color you want. However, in Palazzo, you do need to make sure that the currency is the same type. So you want to use 2 or 3 or 4 cards, whatever it is, of the same type as you're purchasing something. The wild card color or denomination is an exception to that rule. You can add it and combine it with the other colors. Now, there is an additional exception to the rule of keeping one colored currency in Palazzo, and it's if you play 3 cards that are the same exact number. So, for example, I have 2 sixes here of a different currency. Let's say I had a 3rd 6. I could play these all together, and not only would that break and nullify the rule of just having one colored currency, but it would also mean that the value of those 3 cards would equal 15 on the dot. So it doesn't matter if the 3 numbers combined are higher than 15 or lower than 15. If you play 3 cards with the same exact number, they're going to total to 15 money. Now, along with that set of 3 cards that you play, you can play additional cards. Again, keeping with the rule of matching currencies and so on and so forth. Okay, so there is that as far as the currency. Now let's talk about the spatial element. Both of these games have a spatial element. You're not just drafting tiles willy-nilly and not thinking about it. For example, in Alhambra, you have your starting player tile, and you're working your way around that tile. And every time you draft a tile and you're thinking about where to place it, you have to factor things in like, are there walls? Is there a path? If I place this tile down, is there a path that traces all the way back to the home or starting tile that the player had, right? So you're factoring all these things in. You can never have wall to wall. You can never rotate your tiles. The orientation always stays the same. A wall cannot touch a wall, right? Or a wall, actually a wall can touch a wall. A wall cannot touch a blank space. So this right here would be an illegal move. A non-walled space cannot go there, right? So a walled space would be able to go there. But no matter what, you do have to follow the rule of, can you trace a path all the way back to the starting tile? And you may or may not. Also, the walls are very valuable because there's going to be 3 scoring rounds in Alhambra, which are not necessarily random. There are cards here that trigger the scoring rounds when they're drawn. So once those cards are drawn, we will score. And you're going to score for having sets of the different colors, majorities in the different sets. But you also score bonus points for walls, every consecutive or the longest consecutive wall that you can trace around your Alhambra, you're going to score 1 point for each of those walls at the end of each of these 3 scoring rounds. So that's very, very helpful. In Palazzo, what you're doing is you're building separate building structures. You're hoping for all of them to have at least 2 levels, because any building that only has 1 level is actually going to score you negative points at the end of the game. But ideally, you want them to have all 5 potential levels in the building, right? Because that's going to score you tons of points. Also in Palazzo, you are ideally trying to keep them monolithic. You want them to just be one material. If that can't happen, that's fine. But again, you will score bonus points if your buildings are each made of just one material. Also in Palazzo, just like you're looking out for walls in Alhambra, you're looking out for the windows, because each tile either has one, two, or three windows on it. And those windows, the more windows there are on a tile, the more points it will score for you at the end of the game. So you're absolutely keeping track of those windows as you draft the tiles. Now, one very important thing about Alhambra is, first of all, you have the score track. So as the game progresses, you always have an idea of how you're doing in relation to all the other players. In Palazzo, the game, you can look over at your player's tableau or their player area and have an idea as to how they're doing, but you're probably not doing any number crunching, and you definitely don't have a scoreboard to keep track of that. Another very, very important thing about Alhambra is the ending of the game. Because in Alhambra, the game ends once there are not enough tiles to fill up the market. So as you're going through the game and drawing tiles here on your turn, you have a very good idea as to when the game is running out. And you are more likely than not going to know when it's the last turn. In Palazzo, what happens is in the level 3 or the age 3 or round 3 stack here, you have 5 different tiles that form a little panorama, a Roman panorama. And once you draw the 5th tile that completes that panorama, that is an abrupt end to the game. Even that current player does not finish out their turn. So with this game, you have an idea that the game is coming to an end, because more likely than not, there's the 4th of those 5 tiles drawn, but it can still sneak up on you abruptly and be very disappointing as far as that is concerned. Now, in Alhambra, you have a set collection and a majority game taking place, almost like a stock market, so to speak, where players score based on having the majority in a particular set, a secondary, and then eventually at the end of the third round, even for having the tertiary amount in that particular set. Also, not all sets are created equal. The purple is more valuable than the green, which is more valuable than the brown, the white, the brown, the green, the red, and the blue. So it is very stock market-like in that regard as far as that's concerned. Palazzo, it's not a majority game. It's not a set collection game. There's only 3 different types of materials, and it doesn't even matter if you're missing an entire material altogether. What you're trying to do is to be efficient and build structures that are as tall as possible, that are as consistent as possible within their material type, right? And that have as many windows adorning them as possible to add to all those points. You want to be very efficient. You do not want to have small buildings that are only one level, not even 2-level buildings, because they won't score you negative points, but they won't score you positive points. You want to have structures that are at least 3 levels and higher. And again, you want to have a good amount of windows on them so that they could score you lots of points. So there's totally different as far as your aim is concerned and how you score. But again, some similarities with the idea of markets that you need to purchase tiles from, that you need to place in your player area, that have some sort of spatial relationship to one another in your decision-making processes. Really cool. Let's get back to hear my final thoughts on this comparison. So that was Palazzo and Alhambra. These are both games that I enjoy, I love. Games that I don't envision ever leaving my collection and that serve their purposes, and they're both very similar. With that being said, again, let's talk about breaking it down, the comparisons. I talked about components already. I kind of alluded to it. Alhambra is clearly the better game from a production standpoint. No way you're going to see these two games on the shelf, not knowing anything about them, and ever pick this one over this one. It's not just the size. It's not just the colors. It's not just the art. But it's the collective whole of all of these things. Also, if you look at the back cover of it, and if you take a peek inside the box, see an unboxing video or what have you, you're absolutely going to pick Alhambra over Palazzo any day of the week. Now, let's talk about which of these two games serves as a better gateway experience, a game that you want to use to introduce your non-gaming friends, your casual friends and family into the gaming world and the gaming hobby. And I'm going to absolutely have to go with Alhambra. First of all, again, all that stuff about production and components, all of that leads toward the fact that this game is going to be more appealing. It's going to attract more people. It's more likely to give a better and longer lasting impression on players than Palazzo would. So, of course, this makes for a better gateway game just for those reasons. Also, the mechanisms. I do feel that this game is a little bit more intuitive. There are some nuanced details to Palazzo that for a casual gamer or a non-gamer, they might forget some of these things, like sometimes even just the rotating of the master builder clockwise could get confusing. The remembering how much each tile costs, if it's in the material supply board, as opposed to when you're interacting with auctions on the other market spaces. This is a lot more intuitive. It pretty much stays the same. It has nice player aids to keep reminding you of how the points are scored from round to round and so on and so forth. So again, from all those perspectives, I would say that this is an easier game to grok, an easier game to understand, and therefore makes for a better gateway experience. Now, with that being said, again, Alhambra is going to be the more marketable game out of the two. That is clear. But as far as gameplay is concerned, I am still going to give the edge to Palazzo. Palazzo is probably the game that I'm going to go with out of these two if I had to pick one to keep in my collection. First of all, I just love the idea that for the purchase phase, you have an option of auction versus buy, which adds another level of complexity, a little wrinkle to it that makes you think. And I'm always personally a fan of additional options as long as they don't get carried away and perhaps too unnecessarily complex. In Alhambra, you just go and you straightforward buy something from the four markets and you might choose which market you want to get from. Do you want to overpay or what have you? But in Palazzo, again, you have that choice. Do I want to go for these tiles here? I'm going to have to get into a bidding war and I might lose even though I do have an advantage when that with that Certificato card that gives me a head start of 3 money. Or do I just want to not risk it, get some of these tiles from the material supply, probably fewer tiles more likely, and maybe tiles that I'm less interested in, but I know I'm going to get them and nobody's going to mess with me, right? So figuring all these things out is really cool. Also, just manipulating the market so that you can have more of those tiles added to the supply, to the material supply, because the more tiles gather up there, the cheaper they will be. So in the future, you could pay less for them. Hopefully your opponents don't beat you to the punch. I think that's really cool. That's really neat. I like the idea of the triplets, the three cards of one number type being the exception to the rule. Generally speaking, you want to play currency cards of the same color. But if you find a way to gather three cards of the same number, you could use it. And it's really cool that even if those are like very low currency cards that might be worth not too much money, if you combine the three of them, they turn into 15 money all of a sudden and now you're talking. I find that to be very, very neat, very interesting. I like the acquiring or gaining money phase of the game where, yes, you're going to have to draw cards and you're going to be excited about what you can get, but potentially you're helping your opponents by giving them one very valuable currency card to add to their stack. So it's almost like a game of chicken. Who's going to take that gaining money action first and figuring out when's the right time for you to make that decision. I love the idea that the game encourages you to keep your buildings, your structures in one material, but it doesn't force you to. You can choose to mix and match materials if that's the way the game plays out, if that's what you so please, but you are encouraged to try your best to keep them monolithic, to keep them with one material, because you will get further bonus victory points at the end of the game if you do. I think Palazzo is by far and away the better two-player experience. And I do lots of two-player gaming. These are games that I play with my wife in particular. And one of the reasons why is because Alhambra has a nice, neat dummy player variant for two-player gameplay. And a lot of people criticize it. I do think it's very functional, but yes, it's not optimal. You want to play this game with three, maybe even four people. It does play up to 5 and 6. I think maybe 4 or 5 perhaps is pushing it. But the interesting thing about Alhambra, and one of the reasons why it has to have a dummy player, is because Alhambra is essentially a stock market game. Again, we're talking about having these primary, secondary, and tertiary shares, so to speak, in these different colored sets that you're trying to acquire. And because of that, it needs a third player. How can you have a stock market type game without a third player? It's not as optimal, it's not as interesting. Even the classic game Acquire, which is a stock market game, needed a dummy player if you were going to play two players, right? If you play Airlines Europe, another stock market game, if you're going to play two players, there's going to be a dummy player. Palazzo, there is no majority, there's no set collection, there is no stock market taking place, so there is no need for a third player, and that's why it plays very well with two. The gameplay overall is just a much tighter experience. I like tight games that are a little stingy in nature and really make you calculate and think through your decisions because you're afraid of the consequences on the other side. Alhambra is probably a little bit more of a generous game in that regard. Everybody's going to do very, very well. Some people will do better than others, and obviously one person will win. But I feel like the gameplay in Palazzo is a much tighter experience. I prefer the cadence and the ending in Palazzo. The Alhambra, each round gets much more valuable in points. The exponential growth of how much you're going to score from round to round is rather drastic. So much to the point that if two-thirds into the game, let's say after the second scoring round, you are in a convincing lead, well, guess what? It doesn't matter. Whoever's way behind, they can just have one really, really good round, the third round, and they could wipe the floor with you. And that's cool. That's awesome. Again, from a gateway perspective, it's great to know that a rookie or an inexperienced player can always feel like they have a good chance of winning and they don't want to quit the game kind of thing. But I prefer Palazzo, where you cannot take for granted. Every round is pretty much the same. Yes, there's some progression to the building tiles that are available in the different stacks, but there's nothing to blow your mind or to completely undo a huge lead, right? So that's cool. And also the fact that the randomness of the abrupt ending, you have five tiles that are randomly shuffled into that third stack. And once the fifth one in this panorama is drawn, it's an abrupt ending to the game. That keeps the players honest. There is no guarantee, even for the leader or for whoever else is playing, that they're going to have an amazing third round, because we don't know how many tiles into that stack that fifth tile is going to find itself in. So you might only get a few tiles from the third round, or maybe not even any, and the game will end. So you want to be playing well and efficiently from the very get-go. So again, as far as the cadence and ending is concerned, I'm going to have to give it to Palazzo. And yeah, overall, I would just say that I prefer Palazzo as a game. I still love Alhambra. I've been playing it a lot with some of its expansion modules from different expansions, and that adds a lot to the gameplay and adds a lot to the experience. I do enjoy playing it with the expansions. And maybe if, as I play more and more expansions and add more modules to it, that might actually help bump up Alhambra. But definitely, if you're just talking about the base game to base game product, in my eyes, Palazzo is the superior product. And that's it for today's episode of Board Game Comparison. How about you consider clicking on one of the videos on the screen? If YouTube is recommending them to you, it's because they think there's a really good chance that you will like one of them. Also, click on the description down below and check out my Patreon page so that you can see how you can support this channel and become more involved in the behind the scenes process. Research and find a tier that works for you. This is Harry saying take care, everybody. Stay safe, stay healthy, and have fun gaming. Bye.